Hi, welcome to the session. So today we are going to talk about automated machine learning. Before we get started, fans, how many of you have built machine learning models? Looks like. How many of you know how machine learning works? Okay, thanks. So I'm part of the automated machine learning team in Microsoft. My name is Deepak Mukunthu. So this session we'll cover it in three parts roughly. We'll talk about what generally machine learning model building process takes and what are the challenges there. And then we'll define automated machine learning in terms of how it works and how it helps. And then at the Is this better? Should we increase more? Can you increase the volume, please? Is this better? Better? Okay, thanks. So yeah, we'll talk about machine learning process in general and what challenges it has, how automated machine learning can help, and how automated machine learning works behind the scenes. And then I'll end with a demo showing how you can use it today, regardless of your experience in machine learning. Okay, so with that, I think almost every one of us know that AI and ML is a trend now. This just shows one number from Gartner, which predicts that by 2022, this much of revenue or attribution will go towards AI or machine learning in enterprise. And where is all this money going to come from? Are there specific scenarios which will bring money, like a slice of this? It looks like we may be trying to predict which area is hot in terms of machine learning and AI, but the answer to that is almost every area across marketing, sales, service, finance, operations, workforce, any scenarios you talk about, there is chance for machine learning to help that scenario. Right? So with that, I'm not going to spend a lot of time going through each of these scenarios in detail, but I hope if you look at this slide, some of these scenarios resonate with what you do or what you're interested in doing. When enterprises start looking at machine learning for these areas, first thing they start looking at is they don't have data scientists, they don't know how to build machine learning models. So typically they go for pre-built services, pre-built AI services that big cloud providers like Microsoft offer. In Microsoft, we have this concept of cognitive services, which is Microsoft-built models are hosted and made as REST endpoints for services, as services for you guys to call, where you don't need to build any machine learning models. So if you asked me what is the best way to get started with machine learning, that is probably the best way to get started with machine learning and infusing AI into your application or your workflow, whatever you want to do, without getting into the details of building a machine learning model yourself. But why do then people build machine learning models? It's because most of those cloud offerings are generic. They may not be suitable for your own scenarios. For your own scenarios, you may want to customize models to suit your needs, which is where you end up building your own machine learning models. With automated machine learning, what we are suggesting is start from this, because it's a system which is going to automatically produce the best model pipeline for you, and if you want to customize more, then you go and improve that pipeline further. So with that, I'm going to talk about what typical machine learning model building process takes. Right? We are going to take a very, very simple example of car price prediction. So let's say you are a data scientist or you want to build a machine learning model which predicts the price of a car. How do you get started with this problem? So typically, you start with what features make sense. So the features are basically inputs that makes a good model for the scenario. Good features in this case could be things like mileage, condition, age of the car, make, model of the car, anything that you think is an important attribute of the car or the surrounding things that determines the price of the car is a feature or an input variable. Once you identify the features, the next thing is an algorithm. Right? So there are a bunch of options you have. Typically, data scientists pick the favorite that they are familiar with, and then comes hyperparameters, which are basically parameters that help your model produce the result. So these are the parameters that guide your model through the process of prediction, right? So with these three in mind, typically data scientists start with a good set of features. Let's say I start with mileage, brand, and make, right? And then I go and pick an algorithm. In this case, I'm picking gradient boosted trees, for example. And then for each of the, for that algorithm, there are a bunch of hyperparameters that I pick. So each of this will have n number of values to pick from, which means that you have so many combinations to try. So just with one algorithm and those three features, for example, you have at least 5 into these many combinations to try as machine learning pipelines, right? So you start with one combination and then you get to a model, let's say the model is 30% accurate, not good enough. So you go back. You go back and try to figure out the some other parameters for the same algorithm, will it give a better result? In most cases, you go back and pick a different algorithm. In this case, I'm picking KNN after gradient boosting. In a lot of cases, data scientists go back and figure out new features to add to get to a good model. So this is a pretty iterative process. So as this shows, you go through all these combinations and then finally you get to a model which meets your needs or your bar, and then you go and deploy that model in production and you get a car price prediction service out which you can use, right? As you can see, this is a building machine learning model is a pretty iterative and time consuming process, and a lot of this can be automated. So as you can see, this is not rocket science, right? You're trying out different combinations. You can do a for loop with the three level for loops, simplistically speaking. But that means you are basically doing a brute force search of all possible combinations, which may not be suitable for your scenario because you are going to spend time and money. If you are using compute, you are basically trying to, you are going to spend money. So you need something that can automatically figure out the right machine learning pipelines for you to try given your input problem and your data set, right? So which is where automated machine learning comes in. So with automated machine learning, this is a system which will give you the best machine learning pipeline for your scenario. And all you need to bring is an input data. So this is just a hypothetical view of the system. So think of this, the middle piece as the system. The three inputs you bring is your data. So you indicate your data in whatever form you have, and then you indicate the metric you want to optimize or a goal that you're trying to optimize for. And then because the system is going to try different combinations, you also need to guide the system by providing some constraints. Constraints could be things like, I don't want to try more than 50 models. I don't want to spend more than 2 hours. Things like those are constraints, right? So you bring these three as inputs and the system is going to automatically give you the best model or a good set of models that you can choose from. So that's at a high level what automated machine learning is and how it works. We are going to go in detail on how this middle piece works in a bit, but this is a very, very high level view of how the system works, right? So who is this for? Is this for data scientists? Is this for people who do not know machine learning or Python? The answer is that when we started this journey of automated machine learning, we started with data scientists. So the Accelerate AI was our mission. And the focus there was data scientists spend so much time, as we saw, building a good machine learning model. What if we could automate that? So that data scientists, instead of spending weeks to get to a good baseline model, can get a good baseline model in a couple of hours. So that was the goal, which is where Accelerating AI as a mission came in. And then as we started pitching this to customers and customers started using it, we started a lot of customers saying, we don't have professional data scientists. We don't know people who have this end-to-end machine learning expertise. We have data analysts. We have engineers who want to build machine learning models because we saw in the first couple of slides how the demand is high for AI, but at the same time, supply of good data scientists is very low. So to meet the supply versus demand problem for building machine learning models, you need to enable people who are not data scientists, who are domain experts, data engineers, data people, to be able to build machine learning models. So that's where we started then from Accelerate AI. We added Democratizing AI also as a mission, and I'm going to show you how we are enabling that at the end of the deck. And you can, regardless of your experience in ML, you can try out. We have different offerings you can try out. And then as we mature and as customers matured through the process, we started seeing patterns around customers saying, I have hundreds of windmills, right? And I want to build one machine learning model for a mill, but then different mills have different characteristics, different inputs. So I want slightly different models for different mills. So I'm working with a customer today who is a banking customer, and they want to build different machine learning models for different ATMs to predict how much money to put in the ATM on a regular basis, depending on how their customers in that locality withdraw money. So there is a need for easily scaling out machine learning models from one model to many models, which is where we are now investing in scaling AI as a mission, right? So with that, I'm going to spend the next 10 minutes or so going deep on how this works. It may be a little deep. I'll try to keep it as easy and as high level as possible. When you look at hyperparameter tuning, which is the third phase of machine learning models, the first phase was feature selection. Second phase was algorithm selection, then hyperparameter tuning, which is for the features and algorithms, just tuning hyperparameters. Just for that last phase, How do you solve it? There are various options today: grid search, random search, and Bayesian optimization. And there are theories around which one is better or worse. But each of this is going to be a time-consuming process. And even if you just spin it off, the machine itself takes so much time to figure out the right hyperparameter combinations. This is just one of the three steps of the problem space. These things work, but with caveat, right? So these things work well when you have when your number of hyperparameters is less than 10. Which in most cases not true. In most cases, your hyperparameters are a large space than 10. So these approaches may not work out well. You're willing to wait. This is going to try out many different combinations. So you need to be able to willing to wait. And there's also an assumption that parameters are continuous and not discrete. As soon as you get into like parameters that are combination of continuous versus discrete, you need different solutions. And those the three approaches, simple approaches we talked about, will not work. So now with automated machine learning on Azure, which is the team I'm part of, Microsoft Research came up with the breakthrough research, and that's what we are using as part of our automated ML offering. So the research had two key intuitions that the whole system is based on. First key intuition is that given there are so many different possible ML pipelines around featureize, around pre-processing, the first step is typically pre-processing, and then your algorithm selection, hyperparameter selection, the number of pipelines that you can think of is so big that it's a continuous space, right? For us to be able to make a system which can automatically detect or identify machine learning pipelines, we need to discretize it. So that was the first intuition, discretizing ML pipelines. And then second one was, we cannot treat each data set as a separate entity on its own. We need to start seeing patterns between data sets so that when you bring a data set, when we look at your data set in terms of characteristics, we know that this data set is like this data, other data set that we know of, where this kind of a pipeline worked well. So we can now map and say that your data set is close to the other data set we have seen before, so this pipeline works better for your data set. These are the two intuitions on which the system is built. The system essentially is, as you can see in the background, is like Netflix or any streaming service which recommends things for users based on their interest. Right? So this is a recommendation system which recommends machine learning pipelines given your data set. Think of it that way. Plus, it is also backed up by a probabilistic framework which tries to explore and exploit different possible pipelines. So different between exploration and exploitation, quickly talking about it. Exploitation means if you have found out a machine learning pipeline that gives you like 70% accuracy, you can go ahead and just hyperparameter tune that thing. Continuously just hyperparameter tune and in the hope of getting to a better model. Or you can say that, no, that is going to give me locally optimized approach, local maxima. I want to get to a global maxima, which means that I want to not just look at those features and that algorithm, but also try out something else, right? So which is where the system has a good probabilistic approach of balancing between exploration and exploitation, right? So this slide, basically, if you're interested in going deep, that link is a research paper, Microsoft research paper that you can read up. But this link is basically showing you how the system works. It's a combination of collaborative filtering and Bayesian optimization. And it brings uncertainty into account. So the system is going to try to predict the pipeline with the best accuracy or performance, minimizing the uncertainty. Each of the dots here is different pipelines that the system is going to try. So I'm going to just run an animation. So on the top you're seeing is as the system recommends different pipelines, how is the model accuracy or performance increasing over time? And on the bottom you're seeing how the selection of pipelines impacts performance and uncertainty. And the system is going to try out different things in a probabilistic way to maximize performance and minimize uncertainty. So all the blacks here is minimal uncertainty, as you can see. And then the light color means your performance is maximum. So this is how at a high level the system works. Right? So with that, I'm going fast because we have 45 minutes. I'm happy to answer questions offline if you are interested. And this slide deck will be shared, so you don't need to take pictures. And I have links wherever relevant for you to go learn more. This is basically when I talk to customers and say, bring your data and we'll give you a model, people are like, no, I cannot give you my data. Data is so sensitive. So I want to clarify that even though I say data is one of the inputs, we do not read your data. So all we need, so this one, what it's showing is on the left, is your system, this customer subscription or your local machine, wherever you're running your machine learning model training. This is our brain or the meta model that I described how it works. What comes from that side to this side is essentially some metadata from your data. Things like how many rows of data you have, how many columns you have, what data type do you have in each column. We don't even read your column name because even column name can have sensitive information that you don't want to share. Right? So that's the first input that we get on this side. Plus, what is the problem type? Are you doing classification problem, regression problem, forecasting problem, you can specify that. So that's another input that we take. And then the machine learning model, the meta model, recommends the first set of good pipelines that we believe will help you. And then that goes on the on that side, and then training happens on your side. So you control your compute, you control resources for training, and then the results of the training, which is in this case accuracy of the model of each of the pipeline, gets fed back to the system, and the system, based on the accuracy of your models, recommends the next set of pipelines. So this is how the high level system works. So I want to reinforce that we do not see the data. Data is with you. We only get some metadata at a high level, and then the scores of the pipelines. So far we have talked about how automated machine learning can help build a good machine learning model quickly and give you options that you can choose from. But then in the real world, when you want to put models to production, things like transparency become super important, which is where we invest a lot in that. So for example, model interpretability and feature importance. What this means is, for a model, when you have deployed in production, you want to be able to explain each prediction. For example, let's say you have a credit scoring application, or you have a machine learning based system to approve or reject a loan for a customer, banking scenario. If you reject a loan, you cannot tell a customer that your loan got rejected because we have a machine learning model, right? So you need to be able to explain that this model is rejecting your loan, or you don't even need to say this model. The system is rejecting your loan because of these attributes going out of bound of what we think is the right thing, right? So which is where feature importance comes in as one of the key transparency features, which a lot of customers need before they can deploy machine learning models to production. In addition, through the training process, even though we say this is a super magical system which give your data, bring your data, and we'll give you the best model, there needs to be guardrails. Things could go wrong. Your data could have problems. Like, for example, if you have a classification problem where you're trying to predict between loan defaulters versus not, this is a typical class imbalance problem where number of defaulters will be much, much lesser than number of people who are not defaulting, right? So you need to be able to treat your data before feeding into this process, because otherwise the output is just garbage in, garbage out. But the systems like automated machine learning guide you through that process. For example, when you put your data in, we will, through the training process, figure out that your data has imbalance and flag it to you. In some cases, we can automatically fix it for you and tell you that we have fixed it. Things like missing value. So if your data has missing values, we have techniques to automatically figure out the right ways to impute your missing values. And we tell you that we imputed your this column had these many missing values, and we fixed it automatically for you. Things like those. I don't want to go into details here, but the meta point here is performance of the model or getting to a best model is not the only thing. Most customers, before they get put a model in production, want transparency. Right. So with that, now how can you use this stuff? Yes, we automatically do feature engineering also. There's a simple flag. I'm going to show you some. We can take more questions at the end. We do feature engineering also. So now going to how you can use this system. This is our first version, which was a Python SDK, which really we released in December last year. As you can see, this is how you specify your input. So what this is showing is, I don't know if you can read it. Okay. Is it better? Yeah, so what this is showing is you basically indicate your task type. In this case, you're saying, I want to build a regression model. Again, this is a Python SDK, so assumption is that people who are using this know Python and know some level of data science. But I have other experiences which are tuned more towards non-data science folks, which I'll talk through. Here, what you're saying is, my task is a regression task, and my primary metric is R2 score. R2 score is what I want to optimize for. And then iteration timeout is each of the models that you're trying should not take more than 60 minutes for training. And then I don't want to try more than 30 iterations. So what they're saying is, try 30 models, 30 best models you can. Each model should not take, each training pipeline should not take more than 30 minutes. And then maximum concurrency, meaning you can do two at a time, two parallel at a time. So all of these are configurable parameters you can specify. And then we also do cross-fold validation. For example, you don't have to specify an explicit validation data set to us. You can say, I want to do five-fold cross-validation or n-fold cross-validation. We support that. And then pre-process equal to two, true. This is a simple flag. One flag you set, and we automatically do feature engineering for you. Things like, to answer your question, I don't have a slide, but I'll talk about it. The kind of feature engineering we do is simple pre-processing. First, imputation. Missing value imputation is something we do. And then if you have text features, we automatically produce the right features in terms of like n-gram type features, word embedding type features is automatically produced. If you have a date time column, which is very typical in a lot of time series forecasting type scenarios, we automatically figure out good features from that datetime column. Things like week of the year, things that data scientists typically build themselves, we automatically produce it for you. And then we also do, before the training process, we also scale and normalize your data automatically. Because in most cases, you need to normalize and scale your data for the model to do well. So that's a model-specific thing we do automatically also. So all of that is controlled by that just single flag. So you just specify it true and we automatically do it for you. Yes, so we have an API which you can call to get featureized data also. This is a good question. We did not have that when we originally released in December, but we had an update. Correct. Exactly. So the idea is that the system is going to be magical, but it's going to be transparent. Otherwise, you're not going to trust it. So at every point where there could be a black box mindset from customer's point of view, we are trying to open up that black box. Feature engineering was one thing we did not open up when we released it. But since then, I think in April or May, we announced a separate API that you can use to figure out what feature engineering we did and also download featureized data that you can then use to train your own model. For all the pipelines it tried, it will give you exactly what feature engineering happened, what algorithm was selected, and what hyperparameter values. It can take any pipeline ID as an input and give you the exact end-to-end visibility for that pipeline. Another thing I'm going to talk about, which we don't have today, but actively working on, is generating Python code for the training pipeline. So that way, you can use the system to get to a best model, best pipeline, but you don't have to go and recode that. If you want to customize that further, we'll just single click of a button, you can download the Python training script for that pipeline. So that way you will get exact code and then you can go further customize it. So we are focusing on transparency, which is a big. SDK works on local machine also. So I can actually run my own Jupyter server here and then use Python code to run. It requires an Azure authentication. Because to call the meta model, that's the only thing. Otherwise, your data can be here, your training can be on your local machine, but it requires Azure authentication just to call the meta model. Standard Azure Auth or service principle authentication. Yeah. Okay, so this is for data scientists who know Python. But as we said, not everyone is a data scientist, not everyone knows Python. We have some investment around making it easy for those personas. First one, is we enabled a UI, simple UI in the Azure portal. I'm going to show a demo on this, where you don't need to know Python, you don't need to write any code. It's just a UI experience where you bring your data, you specify everything we talked about in the SDK, but through UI, and then go through the training process, and then you can basically download the best model from here or deploy it directly from here, single-click deployment. I'm going to demo it to you. This is a Azure, on Azure portal, Azure ML portal. So with that, let's go through the demo and then we'll come back to other experiences. We have a Power BI integration, SQL integration also. Yeah. The portal is in your subscription. So when you sign into the portal, you're basically using your own subscription, right? So it's data, it's your slice of the public cloud where you have control on everything. We don't see, like Azure doesn't see whatever you have there. We do sophisticated benchmarking, which is to make sure that we are comparing ourselves with other similar competitors. I can name them, but you can follow up with me. We basically say standard, we have a good repository of standard data sets and we compare ourselves with other competitors and see how good we do for a given period of time. Second one is we also try to compete with humans. And that's something we are starting to invest more in, things like competing in Kaggle competition. Compete in Kaggle competition and see how good we do versus humans. I must say that this is not going to replace humans, for sure, right? This is going to give you the power, give you the productivity you need and transparency so you can use this as a baseline system and then go from there. I've heard customers talk about, when I ask them like, why are you not using it? They're like, no, I have my own model. And then on the side, they'll say, I'm still using it because I want to make sure I'm not making a simple mistake. that an automated system can do. So some customers use it in production. Some customers are like, I'm using it to compare myself with this automated system just to make sure I'm not making this silly mistakes. So there is a wide spectrum of customers using stuff. But no, feature engineering also happens in your site. So everything happens in your subscription or on your local machine if that's where you're running. So we don't take. That's a good question, but I had that same question as a PM when my dev was saying I want to do that. Okay, so it's basically Azure. No, it is. We don't charge anything more than your Azure compute. So if you are using Azure, then you pay for the compute that you're using on Azure. This the service itself is not charging anything more for you currently. Yeah. The key competitors we look at are H2O, Data Robot, and these days other companies like Google AutoML tables has come up. Amazon has hyperparameter tuning as an offering. They don't have a full end to end so far, but yeah, those are customers competitors we look at. So this goes back to the feature engineering question. Like, we do look at your data, but that looking at your data happens in your subscription. Because when we do feature engineering, we have to look at your data and see missing values. We cannot. We don't look into your data. We our code, which runs in your subscription, as a client, looks at the data. Right. That's a good question. That's a really good comment. But I want to, the meta thing there for we don't look at your data is that you control your data. That is the meta point, right? Because people can say, oh, if I give you my data and you are going to give me a model, then you are basically looking at my data and you will overfit to my data. So that's not happening is what I'm, that's the meta point that I'm trying to make. Any automation we do around feature engineering happens in your subscription, in your control, which we cannot look at, but we have to look at your data at that point. We meaning the system has to look at your data. Without that, we cannot feature engineer. Sorry? Yeah. So again, I want to reiterate, data is on your subscription. We don't look at it. So think of it this way, right? There could be two models. One is that there is a system, I send it my data and the system does this magic. Or the system has two components, the cloud component and a client component. The client component is sent to my subscription. And the client component is what does feature engineering. The cloud component, which is the brain, recommends the models, right? The algorithm hyperparameter combinations. So that's here. That is what is in our control. Which is where I'm saying we don't look at your data. We only look at your metadata. But for feature engineering, the client components runs on your subscription. And we don't log anything. So your question could be, oh, what if you're logging some stuff there and then sending it to your service? We don't. Whatever we log, we're very, very careful to, again, abide to the same principle of we don't look at your data. So I can share more data with you offline. It's something. So I think the question was data robot has some number of algorithms that it right. How many algorithms we support? I can give you data offline. Those are things that we haven't published publicly yet. But if you have a scenario, we can work with you to say the only thing I can publicly speak about is that I have known customers who have tried data robot and H2O and chosen our offering primarily because of cost and completeness, end-to-end completeness offering. Because with Azure ML, you get the automatic like deployment and MLOps capability, which those offerings, the competitors do not provide. So it's a single place which has AutoML capability, but also has the end-to-end lifecycle management of the model. So that's what interests customers more. But I can talk to you offline. Okay. Yes. We give you the column IDs, right? Plus, that's again that gets sent to the client. So what gets displayed to you is from the client. So the client knows your feature name. What we know is some IDs, right? So when the ID comes to on the client to your, on your subscription, it maps it to the feature name, and then any visualization that gets displayed uses the feature name. That's how it works. Yes. We do. So as part of the transparency work, we do provide the definition so that you can run it yourself. You can run the logic yourself. When I talked about we want to provide the end-to-end Python code for training, we do. One for the first step is the feature transformation logic. Say that again. Yes. So EDA, that is an investment as part of Azure ML. So I will show you a demo if I get time. But as part of that, we are looking at EDA also to be plugged into here. So that way, you can start from your data, do the EDA through the experience, and then bring AutoML. So the end-to-end experience will have EDA into picture also. But we don't have a good story around. Will that also be part of the code that we generate that we don't have yet? Because EDA experience itself is something that we are working on right now. Can you hold that? Can you hold that for the end? I do want to make sure we spend time on the demo, and then I can answer questions. Okay, so this is the codeless experience that we shipped as part of build April May timeframe. This is still a preview capability as part of Azure portal. So basically, what you are seeing here is that these are all different experiments or AutoML runs I have done. So to start a new experiment, I just click on a create experiment, and then give experiment a name. Maybe, and then select a compute. So I'm just going to select a pre-configured compute that I have, but if you don't have, you can create your compute from here. Next, so this is going to now iterate through all the storage accounts I have so that I can use data that I may already have on the storage accounts, or I can upload the data as a CSV file or whatever format you have through this. So in this case, I'm going to just pick a CSV file that I've already uploaded to my storage account, which is for the same scenario we talked through. Right, so this has a bunch of columns. It also has some missing values, as you can see here. You can easily select or unselect features. Like you can say, I want to minimize my training time, so I want to reduce from 20 columns to like 10 columns, and you can basically say, don't include this column or include the other column. Right? And profiling, I don't have time to show this one because this takes like a minute. So basically what this does is, it goes and looks at your data, but not really. We'll be looking at your data. This is running on your subscription. So this goes, looks at your data and shows trends around for each of the columns, how is the data distributed? What is the mean, median, typical things that you would do through EDA experience. This does it. I'm not going to wait for it. This is going to take like a minute or two. And then so once you have seen that, you can specify what is the task type. In this case, it's a regression task. And then target column, which is price in this case, right? That's it. So this is the only minimal inputs that you need to provide, but we want to make sure that this is also catering to like sophisticated people who know machine learning, data scientists, where you can actually control. You can choose a different primary metric you want. We have automatically figured out the right thing for you based on what you gave, but you can choose different things, right? You can specify a number of iterations. You can change job time for each iteration. You can change, you can provide a different validation mechanism if you cross-fold validation mechanism if you want. You can also provide concurrency. This is an interesting one. A lot of customers tell me that, oh, I like light GBM. I know that for my problem, KNN will not work the best. So we provide this capability, or you can select algorithms that you think will work better for you. So that way, we don't search the whole space, but we can search only for the algorithm that you are interested in, and press next. So what's going to happen now is AutoML, the cloud is our cloud is being invoked. And whatever you gave as input is being sent. And then this will now start running different iterations, right? So this is going to, I've done this before. For a 100 iteration run on this data set, it takes anywhere from like 40 minutes to an hour. But I'm going to switch to stuff that I've already run. So this one is exactly same thing, but for, I ran it for I think 20 iterations last time. So once the run is complete, this is what you will see. You will see how the model, how the system tried different models over time. How did things improve? Right, the orange line is basically tracking the best metric. And then for the next thing you can see is you can look at all the pipelines it has tried. So the first, the best and sorted by the metric you are trying to optimize for. In this case, voting ensemble. So ensembling, how many of you are familiar with ensembling? Okay, good. So ensembling is not only trying a single algorithm, but based on good performing algorithms for your run, we automatically figure out the best ones and then ensemble. Now, ensembling is basically, think of it simplistically as averaging out multiple different algorithm output into one and then giving you that final output. Right? So, voting ensemble. So, ensembling typically wins in most cases we have seen ensembling win because it takes the best of multiple algorithms. Right? So, each of these is a single algorithm. So, in this case it's saying it did some standard scalar rapid transform and then it's using random forest. You can also get hyperparameter values through this experience when you go in. So let's look at voting ensemble, for example. So when you look at, when you go through each of the pipeline, we give you graphs that as data scientists you will typically plot yourself. For different problem types, we show different type of charts. This is where if you enabled explainability, we also show you feature importance graphs here. Right? So with this, you can look at it, and then we also compute a bunch of additional metrics that we show here. So it's not only that one primary metric, we also compute around 20 different metrics that you can use for tie breaking. If you have two models that are performing very similar for your primary metric, you want to compare with a separate secondary metric, you can use any of these. And then you can either download the model as a pickle file, which is again a transparency feature. We don't do a black box. You can download the pickle file and go wherever you want to deploy it, or you can deploy it single click from here. Right, so if you do that, so as you can see, this is something I did last week, August 7th, last month. But basically, if you click on this, it's simple. You just give it the deployment a name. You are asking it to automatically generate your scoring script that will be used when the model is scored after deployment, and that's it. So it's a single click deployment. So you click on the deploy button. So model name is required. Okay. So let's say ODSC demo deploy. So now this is going to take the best model, in this case voting ensemble, create a container for you, an ACI container in this case, and then deploy it. So it's going to take 20 minutes. So once the deployment is complete, this would turn green, like you saw in the just like a few seconds back, with a link to a web service that you can use in your application to call the model. So this is a very simple, like no code experience to train a model, get to a web service. So web service you can either invoke in your application, or you can, we also have deep integration with Power BI. So if you are a Power BI analyst, you can actually consume the web service through Power BI, and I'm going to quickly show you how you do that. So in Power BI, you have this entity, the concept of data flows, which has the concept of entities. Think of this as a SQL database with tables. So each of the entities is logically a table. In this case, I have car price as a table or entity. You click on this to go in the entity to explore. So this is going to take a few seconds, but once this loads up, you will see a new option called AI Insights. So you click on the AI Insights, and it will give you options to query or consume any Azure ML models that you have built, including models built through automated machine learning in Azure. Right? So this one is going to now it's looking for this user what models this user has access to. So in this case, this user has access to around 8 different Azure machine learning models. I'm going to pick a model that I deployed in the past, same car price, same flow that we saw in the UI, deployed web service. And then when I hit apply, this is going to now go and create a new column in the same data entity and invoke the model for each row and then populate that last column. So you see here, so this one is the model populated column price, and this one is the original price. So as you can see, original price also had missing values, but you can, when the model, we spent hardly what, an hour to build a model with just 20 iterations, and that came this close to the label column. But you can imagine if you want to try a better model, you spend like maybe 2 hours, you'll get a much better model. Plus with the transparency feature, when we have the code generated, you can go and customize that model however you want. Correct. That's a good question. Yes, currently we support supervised learning only. Unsupervised learning is on our roadmap. Similarly, we do not support deep learning currently. We only support classical machine learning, but deep learning is coming soon. Unsupervised learning in terms of like clustering is slightly far out, but deep learning using images and stuff is coming soon. That's a good ask. A lot of customers ask that. We do not support that today because the challenge is that the meta model, the brain needs to be retrained for any new primary metric we add. Right? So if you have a metric that you think is generic enough that applies to almost everyone, then we can work with you to make that as the primary metric we support. But if you have your own custom metric, that's something that we cannot support because we are a generic service. Okay, just a minute. So before people are moving off, I want to show you other experiences we have, and then we can take questions. Like, give me a minute. So we talked about the UI demo and then consuming it in Power BI. If you are a Power BI analyst and you want to build a machine learning model in Power BI yourself, this is the experience. So you have a very similar experience to what you saw in the Azure UI, but a much more simplistic one. So here, we don't even give you all the pipelines we tried. We only give you the best pipeline. Because for analysts, we don't believe they have the ability or inclination to compare different models. Right? So all they're looking for is give me the best model you can for a given period of time. So that's this experience for Power BI analyst. We also have a Visual Studio experience for C# developers. If you're not a Python developer, but you are a coding person, you are a C#.NET developer, we have the exact same backend cloud supported in C# that you can use, similar to the Python experience we saw in the beginning. Right? The last one is SQL Server. A lot of people say, oh, my data is in SQL and I am a SQL expert. I don't know Python, I don't know C#, but I like SQL. We also have a SQL stored proc based approach, which again uses the exact same backend workflow we saw, but coding wise, you code in SQL. Right. So with that, we are seeing, so this is the last real slide. So a lot of customers have multidisciplinary teams, some data scientists, some developers, some analysts, and they want to collaborate, right? So with that in mind, what we are doing here is we already enabled this flow. This is the demo we saw, right? You built a model using Azure, using AutoML, and then you consumed it in Power BI. That's the demo we saw. But the other flow that people are asking is, I'm an analyst, I built model in Power BI using AutoML, but I want to give that to my data scientist. So the data scientist can go approve, review, approve, or improve. So that's where we are working on this one. This feature where with a single click of a button from here, analysts can export the model, either the full training code or the best model training code as a Python script that can then the data scientists can look at. So this is where we are seeing a lot of collaboration capabilities needed as customers and companies are maturing in AI, different personas working together, and we'll continue to support these collaboration experiences. So with that, like two of the customer use cases where they are using automated machine learning in production, Schneider Electric and BP. And we have more and happy to share. That is the stuff that I said is work in progress, the flow, this arrow. So this arrow, the intent of this arrow is that whatever AutoML did here, I should be able to say, give me a training script that I can run, redoing the whole thing, or give me a training script for the best pipeline only, as a Python script. That is this work, and it's happening. We are actively working on it. Should have something in the next couple of months.
So I have two questions. One was asking, can we do custom models here? So if I have a
Yes, so recommendation scenario is work in progress. We currently support the bare bone things like classification, regression, and forecasting. Forecasting is one of the meta scenarios we added recently, but the collaborative filtering type recommendations. We behind the scenes use collaborative filtering for the system, but enabling that as a customer scenario is work in progress. To your original question on custom models, again, answer is the same as the primary metric question, which is we can support a new model if you think it's generic enough that will be useful for other customers also. Given we are a platform, it's hard for us to support any custom stuff. But that said, we are transparent. So you can actually use this as a baseline and then use your own algorithms to compare.
One last thing is the web services which is being populated, right?
Yes.
Is that production grade? So can I directly
yes.
integrate that with
yes. Yes, it is part of Azure ML. So it's an Azure ML web service which has all the HTTPS support and any enterprise security related readiness that you can go ahead and use. Yes. Yes. Sure. I have documentation links where we talk about exactly what kind of, how do we impute data. So just to be clear, whatever we have in production today is based on research, right? But customers are using it for the real world scenario. No, we don't have anything kept just for insider community. Just to be very, very transparent, right? DNN. So DNN support, there is like cutting edge research that's already happened, papers published called NAS. It's called network something search, neural architecture search. Okay? So that's for basically searching DNN models. Given your data, what is the good DNN network that works well for that data set? We haven't worked on that yet, but that's something that research has already published papers on. Right? The intent is not to save that for ourselves. It's just that research is always like 5 years in advance, right? So we will catch up there. And as part of our DNN investment, we are looking at enabling some of this NAS research into the product. But think of this as, this research was published in 2015. We have that in production 2018. So that's the phase that we are going.
Just to follow up to that.
Yeah.
So apart from using the metadata for choosing the best model, do you use the metadata for anything
else? Metadata for like feature engineering, for example. For feature engineering, like column name, somebody asked the question, right? So there we operate on column IDs, but then we need to be able to show it back to the user in the column name. We haven't done that. We haven't done that yet. I don't know if we will do that anytime soon, but we haven't done that.
So your recommendation system today is
based on like public. It's based on public data, public models that on those data. It's not being retrained on, it's not being retrained with real customer scenarios yet.
See, in a typical brute force analysis, what we do is we use PCN probably.
Yes.
There are some attributes that come back and say these are the high performing attributes.
Yes.
But then that does not matter the business most cases.
Correct.
Okay. In your case, if you're going to generate us more scenarios, more models,
yeah,
it's going to bring more anomaly to my model and I'm going to get confused as a data scientist. So how is it going to
say that again? So why will you be more confused?
See, you're going to test on more attributes and bring more models.
Correct. In. Yes.
Okay, which may or may not be really, you know, important to the business.
Yeah.
So
yeah.
That's
a good question. That's a good question. So as part of the feature engineering transparency I talked about, we also give you an ability to override our feature engineering. So you can look at what feature engineering we have done, and you can say, I don't want to do these things. I want to do just these from you. Plus, I want to do this one extra thing. We enable that as part of the SDK we released. So that was a good customer. A lot of customers asked that question. I want to customize feature engineering.
So one last question. What's yeah. the trend? Is the data analyst using it more or the data scientist using it?
Everyone. So the trend, you know, it's an interesting question because as part of the collaboration, I'm seeing patterns around some customers, some companies having a mixed set of data scientists and data analysts, right? Some companies are happy to say for simple like low business impact and low business critical problems, analysts can go build a model, deploy it on their own. But a lot of customers are saying that no, data scientist needs to review and approve that. But the trend, there are mixed trends, but everybody, almost every customer is saying data scientist resources are hard to find. So they are augmenting data science team with these citizen data scientists or analysts who are domain experts who know data but want to learn ML. So that's the trend I'm seeing.
All right, we'll take one last question and we'll do a hard stop and then you can talk to the speaker offline, sorry.
It is, so the single click deploy I showed automatically enables that. So you click single click deploy and we automatically generate the right metadata for Power BI to understand and query.
Okay. And
so
that can be included as a part of your ADF pipeline.
Correct, yeah. So as part of our overall Azure ML ML Ops story, ML operation story, we have that covered. So this is, I just talked about automated ML, but there's a like broad spectrum of Azure ML capabilities that you can get for free. So that finishes the end to end.
Thank you so much.